Hello YouTubers and welcome to this T4D. Right, so sitting behind me, very hard to miss, I've gone and received two boxes from RS Components. Obviously Paolo's sent both the oscilloscope and the power supply. I'm not sure which is, I haven't even opened them yet, so I'm not sure what is in what box. I'm going to open these up and ultimately just make sure they've arrived safely. But then the oscilloscope I'll leave in the box because it basically looks like the one that we've already seen on my bench. But the power supply I'm certainly intrigued to see because I've not had one of those in my hand. So we're going to put that on the bench and have a closer look at that and see how it operates. Then just another note, for those of you who are entering these competitions, you can enter, certainly if you are going to be entering, you can post directly on the Google Plus page, to Paolo's Google Plus page. So you don't have to go through my forum. I initially said that because I hadn't realized you'd be able to directly post there. I'm not a social media fundi, but you can post directly to Paolo's Google Plus page. I'll put the link down here. Obviously the details are in the previous T4D. And you can like it and follow him. You'd be then entered into the competition for the power supply, which we're obviously going to take a look at now. What has also come, and it will be a while before we get to actually do this. I recently obviously did the look inside that Heathbuilt voltage reference. And obviously I've got the Fluke 332D. Now I had intended actually doing the 332D before the Heath, but I didn't have a manual with it. And I had the manual for the Heath. I went and found a manual off eBay. I've got an original 332D. So this is Fluke, John Fluke. It's the instruction manual. It's got schematic diagrams. There's a whole lot, wealth of information in here. So in time to come, we'll have a look at the manual and then open up the actual device. To the best of my knowledge, we'll see how it works and see if we can calibrate it. Then, kind of for a laugh and just out of intrigue, I don't know if any of you recently have been watching television, have seen Duracell advertising these quantum batteries. And it notes on there, they say high density core. And it says, it's got here in several places, world's number one longest lasting. So I'm very intrigued by that claim because these are alkaline batteries. And it doesn't say world's longest lasting alkaline battery. Underneath it says Duracell, it gives the name Duracell AA alkaline, but it doesn't say alkaline battery. Now Energizer do a lithium battery, which really does last a long time. So I've already got all the stats and figures for that. So I'm going to put these on either my battery tester or my electronic DC load and see what capacity these do have and then release it on the spreadsheet. So I say, I'm always intrigued to see when someone comes out with a bold statement like that, and I'm fairly confident that can be proved wrong. Hopefully soon I'll have the figures for that. Right, let me open up these boxes. We'll just double check everything's okay, and then we'll put the power supply on the bench. Right, so here we go. Here's the scope. As you can see, it's obviously the same layout as the one that I've been using, but this one is the 100 megahertz version, as noted at the bottom there. And then it comes with obviously the normal accessories, a set of probes. It's got two European plugs, so obviously I don't know where in the world it's going to at the moment, but if it does go to someone in the States, I'll throw in a US plug as well. It's universal, so it doesn't matter whether you're putting in 220, 240 or 110. And you don't even have to switch it, obviously automatically switches. So I'll put in the right cable. And then here is the Arduino kit that actually comes with it. So I'll pop that back in the box and then I'll have the power supply out. Right, so here it is. It's a big beast, it has to be said. I'm gonna swing it around so you can actually see the back just now. But just to note, so this is obviously the Isotek IPS3202. It's got the triple outputs. It's got 30 volt at 2 amp times 2 and then a 6 volt at 5 amp times 1. Off the front here, but we'll see how they operate. We'll certainly put my electronic DC load up to it and just make sure that it can handle a little bit of abuse before I pack it up. Hopefully I don't like it too much because it's one of those things like multimeters, you can never have enough power supplies, I reckon. But anyway, let me swing it around so you can have a look at the back. So here we go, on the back, it's obviously got the fan, it's got an RS232 port. This one does, although it's obviously universal, you do need to actually select the oscilloscope. You don't need to set it. This one I've gone and set for the voltage here. I'll set it back to 230 volts as a safety precaution. So
Or I'll preset it to wherever it's going to. But at worst case, if I don't know your voltage, I'm going to leave it on 230 just for safety reasons. But let's swing it around and get it powered up. Right, so before I power it up, it does obviously come with two power leads. And again, if it does go to someone in the States, I'll pop in a US power cable. This is the manual. This is all sealed at the moment, and it does come with quite a selection of leads by the looks of things. I'm going to try to the best of my ability actually to leave this sealed, so I'm keen to see if I'm able to drive this without actually seeing the manual. Right, so just to note, I've got it on the front of my bench, and I put a little wedge under here just so it's easy for me to film. And I was kind of thinking, should it have the kind of flip out feet that does hold it up at an angle? And looking at all my other power supplies, none of those are set to be raised up. So if you do have this kind of at towards the back of your bench, then obviously imagine it wouldn't be an issue. You'd have it lying kind of flat. But I suppose there may be some situations where you might want it wedged up, and then you're going to have to obviously make a plan. It is heavy. It is obviously got a huge big transformer in there. So you'd have to have something under there which does support it quite nicely. But anyway, let's just see if I power it on. Heavens, and it's obviously like a little mini computer. Right then, so I certainly got a bit carried away because I started playing around just to see that I could get the basic operation going, which I could. And then I kind of went and attached my electronic DC load, which I've got above, and then I wanted to play with the other bits and pieces, and I really got lost in playing with it. So I've got a fair idea of how this device works now. But anyway, so here we go. We've got our screen powered up. On the bottom of the screen here, in the kind of bottom third, you've got your settings for your three channels. And then you've got what's actually happening on the outputs over here in terms of channel 1, 2, and 3. You've got kind of coarse and fine settings. As noted, this the output 3 over here has got a 6 volt at 5 amp. They've each of the channels has got over voltage and over current protection, which I'll demonstrate. The center channel, which acts as your master, so that's this channel over here, that is obviously 32 volts at 2 amp. And then you've got a channel 1, which is the same, 32 volts at 2 amp, but you can electronically put it in parallel with 2, so 2 becomes the master, and then you can double your currents. That is really, really handy, because 2 amp, I would say, is just might be a bit limiting for the normal bench. So if you do want, I mean, my power supplies go up to 3 amp, and 3 amp I find sufficient, but this can go up to 4 amp on a single channel, which is really great. But anyway, okay, so as you can see, we've got the channel 2 highlighted. To change the channels, you've got a shift button over here, and I can simply push over here to go to channel 1 or to channel 3 or to channel 2. On channel 2, I can then go and say, fine, I want to go and set the current. And as you can see, you've got VSET. So if I push VSET over there, I can type in, I want, let's say, 24.5 volts and enter on that. And for ISET, on each of these, you can then also go and use the dial as well. Now, as you can see, it's adjusting at the 10th of an amp over there, or in 100 milliamp steps. You've got a coarse fine button over here. You can see it's gone down to fine, and it is now adjusting down to the single milliamp on there, which is really, really great. So you can do that on the dial, obviously, and once you've got things live as well. You can then go and set your actual step. So if we go shift step, you can define what your steps will be. So if you want them to be coarser or finer, you can go and specifically note what you want set there. Right, so now I'm going to put the external DC load on. So I'm gonna put that load on. I've got the voltage set on there to 45 volts just at the top and for half an amp. So I've got the output on. And then you've got this output button over here, bang. So then you get everything live, and it tells you what mode, whether you're in current limiting or voltage limiting over here, or constant voltage or constant current, I should say. So at the moment, as you can see, it is delivering. So I've got, 1.5 amp set. My electronic DC load is only set for about half an amp. So I can then obviously go and set ISET, I can go and bring this down. I'll go and set it to 0.3, enter. And then go iSet, so I'm sitting there, and I can then adjust that down with a control knob per milliamp over there. So really nice fine control. I can obviously go and step that up and go to the coarse set, so if I want a faster adjustment. And at the moment, as you can see, because the electronic DC load is demanding more, it can't deliver the voltage because the electronic load is set to 0.5 amp. So the next thing we're going to do is go and check, we'll take it right to the top, we'll go and set the voltage to 32 volts, enter on that. We'll go and set the current to, let's set that to 2 amp, or let's say 1.5 for now, enter. Then obviously now it's able to deliver what the electronic DC load is demanding. So what I want to check, I'm going to set my electronic DC load to 2 amp. And again, so we fall over because this is obviously the electronic DC load is pulling too much. But what I want to check is that it can actually deliver the 32 volt at 2 amp. So I'm going to put 2 amp in there, enter. And now it's obviously gone and reset. I'm going to step my electronic DC load down just slightly. Right, so now with the electronic DC load in view, you can see I've got it set to 1.9 amp. And at the moment, it's showing that it's delivering 31.97 volts. And I know this is fairly precise, and we will do a check on the Rheingold a little later. But certainly with the specification, I mean, it's virtually there, so nice and accurate. I'm going to turn the electronic DC load up so it's pulling 2 amp. And now if we go to volt, let's see, yeah, current set. So at the moment, basically, it is delivering. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to just step the, if I take the electronic DC load one more, there we go. It's obviously going to throw it out of kilter. So I've got to come back. But it's definitely being able to deliver. Let's just see. It's saying it's delivering 1.991. Let's just switch the electronic DC load on and off a few times. So I switch it off, on, off, on. And certainly without any hesitation, does certainly seem to jump in, and it's able to deliver that with no problem at all. So the next thing then, let's do its next party trick, is where we pull in channel 1 in parallel. So all I need to do there is go shift, and the button up here has got para or independent. Independent is obviously when all the channels are independent. We go parallel, and you can see it blocks out channel 1 here, and we've just got the channel 2, and obviously you could make adjustments on channel 3, and you can see straight away it sets to 4 amp. So I can go and set that, let's say right now, to 3 amp. And obviously now it's being limited by what's been drawn by the electronic DC load. So we'll just go and step that up. Bang, so we're almost at 3 amp. There we go, 299. So no problem there. If I obviously set to go and try and draw more on the electronic DC load, it's gonna fall over. We'll do that. There we go, so it's now gone and fallen over. So now I'll go to my iSet over here, and I'll go and set that to, let's say, 3.5. I set 3.5, enter, bang, and we're back up and running. And at the top, I've got it at the moment set to 3.4. I'm going to go and set down below to 3.5. So if I go, I set 4, enter. In fact, I think I can go to 4.2. There you go. And then if I obviously start stepping up the DC load, let's just see that it can go to 4. Yep, so we're delivering 32 volts at near enough 4 amp. 4.1. Yep. 4.2. So right on what we're specifying, barring a few ball hairs on the display here, it is delivering the 32 volts at 4 amps. So that, as you can see, is about 134 watts. So let's go and play around with the output. The output off, on, off, on, off, on. No problem at all. So the next thing you can do is have overcurrent protection. Right, so if I now, I've got the current, the voltage set to 32 volts and the current set to 4 amp. If I go and set the overcurrent protection on, I'll put switch the output off, switch the overcurrent protection on, switch on the output, I'll then switch on the electronic DC load. And what I'm assuming's happened there, right, I've been having some fun and games trying to demonstrate the overcurrent protection. So let me just show it when I've got the channel set to independent. So at the moment, I've got obviously the channel 2 set to 32 volts at 1 amp. The electronic DC load is set to actually pull half an amp at the moment. So the overcurrent protection is this button over here. I push that, you can see it says switched on over there. If I switch on the output, we obviously then get our output and it's outputting what it should do. If I then go and step up the current on the electronic DC load, what would normally happen without the overcurrent protection is that the voltage, the output would still be live, but your voltage would fall off because obviously it can't supply. So as we step up now, okay, so we've got our 1 amp, bang. As soon as I go over 1 amp, the overcurrent protection steps in and the output is disabled. To, as you can see, to clear that, you just push it again, switch it off, and the situation is actually cleared. Now what I can't understand, I'm going to hook this up into, so it's got both channels in parallel. So if I go shift parallel, we've got the current here set to 2 amp. So that's fine. We've got the electronic DC load set there. I'm gonna put the overcurrent protection on, output on, we're fine. I'm now gonna just step things up. So we hit, I can see I'm only at 1.1 amp, but yet the overcurrent protection jumps in. So there's something interesting going on. I'm going to go and double check the online manual just to make sure there's nothing I'm missing. Right, I've just gone and checked the manual and certainly what I'm doing is correct. It should literally only once you kind of equal to or exceed the current that you've got set, should it then kind of switch off and protect itself. And at the moment, it seems to be doing that beforehand. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna double check to see if the voltage is coming into play. So I'm gonna drop the voltage down a little bit to 28 volts. We've got it set up to 2 amp, put on the overcurrent protection, and then what we're gonna do, okay, it's still sitting its power. I'm just gonna take it, let's get to our independent modes, just to see if that was coming into play. Put the output on. Okay, and it was at 1 amp, so that's my mistake. So I'm going to clear that. I'm going to set the current to, let's set it to 1.8. Enter. And now we'll switch the overcurrent protection back on. Switch on the device. Okay, so we've got our output. I'm now going to dial up. Okay, there we go. So there it's behaving as it should do. So I'm going to leave that at 1.9, clear that. Let's just go and set the current to 2 amp. Enter. Put the output on. Put the overcurrent protection on. 2. And bang. Okay, so there it's behaving. So let me go put it back into its parallel mode and see if that affects things. So we'll clear that, we'll take it into the parallel mode where I've got up to 4 amp. I'm gonna go and set the current just for 2 amp, enter. Bearing in mind that I reduce the voltage, I don't know if that's coming into play. I'm going to put the output back on. and I'm pulling too much from the top, so I'm going to pull down a bit to 1.7 overcurrent protection, and it bums out straight away. It's funny, so when it's in parallel mode, I don't know whether it just doesn't operate correctly in parallel mode. Let's just try once more. Let's go down to a lesser figure. I'll set my half an amp. I'm going to set this supply down to 1. So it's below the initial kind of single channel mode, if you will. Let's put the overcurrent protection on. Bang. I think there's a bit of a bug here. Let's clear that. Let's set a lower voltage. I'm going to set the voltage to 12 volts. Enter. Overcurrent protection on. And it still falls over. So there's something awry there. Let's just clear that. Let's just go back to independent channels. So 12 volt, half an amp. Although I had my power supply right on half an amp. Silly me. I'm going to go set it to 300 milliamp. Let's just check here again. So we'll go and put it on. Go and put the output on. No problem. Let's go back into the parallel mode. It's got that error over there. I wonder if that's going to be an issue. Let's go shift. Parallel. It's set for 1 amp, 12 volt. And there it comes on okay. Step the current up over here. So if I hit 1 amp, I only hit 600 milliamp. Okay, I'm going to power everything down and start again. Right. Going to start from a clean sheet. There are no errors here. As you can see, I've got 200 milliamp set on the electronic DC load. I'm only driving at 12 volt. I've got half an amp set here. Overcurrent protection, as you can see, is switched on. The electronic DC load is off. We'll start it off like that. We'll put the output on, put on the electronic DC load. So that's fine. We'll start cranking it up. Bang. Okay, and that's what we would expect. No problem there. So we go and clear that. I'll switch the output back off. I'm going to set the limit up to set the current to 2 amp at 12 volt. I'm going to set the overcurrent protection on, and let's switch the output on, switch the electronic DC load on. Okay, we're all fine there. We're going to step it up 1.5, 7, 8, 9. The next one should trigger it. Or just over. Yep. So that behaves. Now what I want to do, I'm going to step this down to about 1.7. Clear the condition. Switch that off. Overcurrent protection on. Okay, that's worked. What I want to do is leave the output on, switch this output off. Okay, so that has worked. That's behaving as it should. So I'm going to come back down to 1.8 amp, clear the error. Now I'm going to go back into, so we've got 2 amps set here. Go into the parallel mode, it jumps up to 4, defaults to 4. I'm going to take this down, I'm going to take this down to 1.4, take the current to 1.5, enter. Okay, so I'll take it up to, let's take it up to 1.6, enter. Overcurrent protection on, output on, and it just fires up straight away. Okay, I'm going to put the output of the electronic DC load off, put that on. Now the output's off, the electronic DC load is off. Fine. No, I'm only drawing 1.4 and this is set to 1.6. So I wonder if there's an issue with this when it's in parallel mode, that the overcurrent protection is not working correctly. Okay, so those are the steps. Paolo can have a look at that. I think there might be a bug there in the way the overcurrent protection is actually working on there. So let's move on from that and show you the over voltage protection. Right, so to go and demonstrate the over voltage protection, what I've gone and done is I've gone back to the independent mode. At the moment, the electronic DC load is set at 11 volts and half an amp. So obviously the risk is that what you can do is your power supply, if you're not watching what you're doing, you can go and set your voltage higher than you should do, and you're going to go and blow something. So if I go to VSET, now I'll show you another way of changing the voltage. One thing you can also do, besides directly dialing in, besides also dialing in on the actual dial itself, you've got the shift, and you can go and actually step up and down on the shifted function. You can see on the individual digits, and you can do the same for the current. So you can adjust the current and the voltage easily over here as well, which is a nice feature. But now if I go to VSET, I'm still in the shifted mode. If I go to channel 2 and I go to VSET, I can obviously go and step up the voltage over here, and potentially I could be blowing whatever I'm driving, because as you can see, if I set this to the 15 volts, you can see we're pulling that. But what you can do, you can go and set over voltage protection. And you do that by basically coming to the OVP set button over here. We push that. I can then say, fine, I don't want it to go above 16 volts. I can enter 16, enter. So that's always a setting that's set there. If you don't want it to come into play, you obviously set it to like 34 volts. And then if I go and set VSET and go and set up, you can then see, if I go and draw more, so I set the electronic DC load to draw more, it'll then jump in and disable the output. Now, that's great. It does protect your circuit. I do wish, though, they gave you the option to either disable or switch off the output, or just hold the level there so that you didn't power off your circuit unexpectedly. So that's one thing I must say I would have liked to have seen in that feature. Once you are in this mode, however, to get out of it, you've got an over voltage protection reset. So then you just go shift, push that, and then you've reset. But obviously if you don't want that to come into play, you obviously go and push the set button over here and go and set that back up to, let's say, 34 volts, so that's not interrupting you. But at least it does give you that peace of mind. Right, then the other button I meant to tell you is shifted features, the W, and that what you can do if you want a bigger, clearer display. If I go put the output on, you can actually switch between the kind of settings, or you can go the shift and go wide to give you a big display over there. In that mode, as you can see, if I go and flick your settings over here, it then just brings it up to the line so that you can go and independently set the voltages still there, but still having the big display. Right, so next we'll demonstrate the third channel, which is obviously set to a maximum of 6 volts at 5 amp, but I can see here I've already gone and set it to 5.2. So if I go shift and then go to channel 3, I've got the DC load ready to pull 5 amp. Switch on the output, and there we go, 6 volts at near enough 5 amp. So no problem with delivering that. Let's just actually switch the output off. On, off, on, no problem there. If I go and step up, let's just see how far it can go. If I go to 5.1, yeah, so it's delivering beyond what it should do. If I go to 5.2, bang, okay, then fair enough, there we hit it where it can't supply. I wonder if we should just check the over current protection here. So I'm going to set this down to 4 amp. It's now obviously delivering that. Let's go and set if I go to switch that on, and we now go and step up. There we go. So that's doing what it should do. Let's just set it down to a lower level to see that it's behaving itself there. So if I go I set, let's go to 4.5 amp. Enter, set this just below that. I'm setting that to 4.2. Put that on, put the out, and again it fires. There's definitely something awry, I think, with the, I'm gonna switch off the output, clear that, put it back on, output on. So we're ready to supply 6 volts at 6.5 amp. I'm not pulling that on the power supply. I'm pulling 4.2. I wonder if it's overshoot. I wonder if there's an inrush current which is firing the protection. Let's just see if that works okay. That must be the problem. I think there's an inrush current coming in from the power supply, which wouldn't be good. Let's go and clear that. I'm sitting at 4 amp. I'm going to go way below. So let's go at 3 amp. We set it 4.5. That is still on. Protection on. So that's fine. No problem there. I'm going to go step up to 4 amp. It handles that okay. Let's go to 4.3. Bang. So I can only assume that there's a little bit of inrush and the sensitivity of the overcurrent protection is jumping into play. Right, so let me next, after showing that, so that is the third, so you've got a third channel there, which obviously 6 volts, which can go up to 5.2 amp, which is a nice thing to have. The next feature it's got is a tracking feature. So we're going to go back to channel 2, because that's the master channel for the tracking. You can control two channels from one setting, basically, and I'll hook up the Rigol so we can see what's going on. Right, so the next thing I'm going to demonstrate is the tracking feature. Now, you'll have to excuse the groovy camera work. Hopefully, you can see all the displays. But I've now got the channel 1 plugged in, and I've got that just to show you what the voltage is. I don't have another DC load, so we'll just use the Rigol for the voltage. And then channel 2 acts as your master controller. So we sit on channel 2, and then if I go shift track, you can see it comes up and it goes into a track mode over there. Then your channel 2, if I, for instance, go and set the voltage, so I've got down set to 5 volts, and you can see on the Rigol, basically spot on, or certainly not far off on the Manuo DC load. So if I just go and crank that up, just as a demonstration of how accurate it is. So 5.28, and we can see 5.28 on the Rigol, and literally ball hair away on the Manuo. So it certainly seems to have a very accurate output, and that's obviously controlling both channels. And likewise for the current, if I was to make current adjustments, then that is being controlled by this channel as well. At the moment, obviously, the load is only drawing so much. If I go and drop that below the 500 marks, if I go to 0.5, enter, then go I set, and then start dropping it, the voltage then drops off, obviously, because I'm not supplying enough current to maintain the actual voltage. We go back up and we're there. But then all those features, both channels will track what you're doing on the channel 2. Right, so that kind of is the main feature list. When I say the main feature list, this can obviously be remotely controlled from your PC. So there's software to remotely run this from your PC. It's also got some memory, so you can go and store specific configurations in a memory and then recall those back as well. So that's probably a fairly broad overview of what it can do.
Right then, so I hope you enjoyed that little overview. I think all in all, it's a great little power supply. Certainly the one big issue there, as noted, is that the overcurrent protection seems to have either a bug or in the software, in the way the software runs and handles it, or an actual fault in the device itself. I would have preferred if the overvoltage protection gave you the option, instead of just disabling the output, just basically held the voltage and didn't disconnect the actual output. I've checked the manual, I don't think that's possible, that's just the way it does work. Certainly a lot of functionality in it, and I think whoever does win it will be really chuffed. It'll be a really nice supply to have on the bench. I would certainly be happy to have this. I mean, when I first saw the specs and I saw it was rated for 2 amp, I thought, okay, that might be a little bit limiting, but it's nice to know that you can at least parallel the two channels together and take it up to just over 4 amp. The other bit of news, you'll know that I spoke about my PC and the hassle I had with the hard drive. Well, believe it or not, it turns out it wasn't the hard drive. I then had another problem with the hard drive, the other SSD that I bought. I put in another hard drive and that then started producing issues and then made me realize that there was actually a problem with my PC. So in a rush last week, I had to literally within a day buy a new brand new PC and then go again recover. So I've spent basically since the half of last week till most of this weekend getting back up and running again. I do have a nice super fast PC now for rendering. I bought something, obviously a latest spec, so at least again it helps with my kind of video editing and rendering, but certainly a little bit of a nightmare. But at least all the hard drives are still functional. I think that my PC, it was dropped when it was being air freighted here. I know that because there's physical damage on the back, and I just think that drop over time has obviously caused an issue. But anyway, thanks very much for watching. Again, if you are entering the competition, as I said, you can load directly up to Paolo's Google Plus page. So you don't have to go through my forum, you can upload it there. It saves Paolo having to upload it himself. Thanks again, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.